Yeah, good afternoon. Norvedemon did an excellent introduction to the second part of the day, which will be devoted, if the first part was more devoted to a kind of autopsy of what has happened in the past. So this this part will be more devoted to what is to be done, and in particular things such as institutional arrangements, institutional reforms, also responsibility, including responsibility of the largest countries, largest players in the Eurozone. We have assembled a splendid, I think, panel for that. Jörg Asmussen, now permanent secretary of state at the Ministry of Labor and Social Affairs in Germany. Jörg Asmussen was also a member of the board of the ECB at the time when Latvia was actually acceding to the Eurozone, so has been very instrumental in that. And finally, he mentions on his website for some reason that he has been born in he was born in Flensburg. So that's for those who don't know, it's where the road traffic directorate in Germany is, where all these penalty points accumulate. So I wonder whether that has had any influence on his personality. Then next we have Professor Christian de Boissieu. Actually, when a couple of days ago I heard that the Nobel Prize has been won by a Frenchman this year, so I thought immediately it must be Professor de Boissieu, but then it turned out it was actually one of the members of the Council of Economic Advisors to the Prime Minister that he was presiding on. So he has been a long time, for 10 years, presiding over the Council of Economic Advisors to the Prime Minister of France. He's now professor at Sorbonne, and he's also teaching at the College of Europe in Bruges, but as he proudly states himself, he pays his taxes in France. And then last but not least, we have Professor Balcerovic. Yesterday, in a very humble manner, he introduced himself as just a head of one department at the Warsaw School of Economics, but actually he's more, I like to compare him, actually his role in Poland, in the post-socialist Poland, if I may say so, was more akin to that of Ludwig Erhard in the post-World War II Germany, so he has been really instrumental in some of the reform efforts that were undertaken by Poland. So with those introductions, now I will give floor in the same order to our excellent panel for initial comments, initial reflections on the topic, and then we have a discussion and hopefully some questions from the audience. So Mr. Asmussen, please.
Yes, thank you very much for inviting me for organizing this conference, Governor, especially personally to you. It's not the easiest task at the end of a very dense morning to speak and to be on the panel, since already Jens Weidmann has alluded to the Hanseatic League, so this was my last line of defense, what I'm gonna say. Because in my view, the euro area is the Hanseatic League of modern times, but you already alluded to this at the beginning, at the end of your speech. So yeah, the Bundesbank has a very well. Yes, so what can I do now, right now? I mean, to boil the debate down, I think one has to simply answer three questions. First, where do we stand? Second, where do we need to go? And third, how do we get there? And the question, where do we stand, that boils down to the question that always journalists ask because it's so spicy, is the euro crisis over? And then normally I spend 15 minutes explaining that this is not a crisis that is caused by the common currency. Yeah, the euro is not at the root cause of the developments that hit some euro area member states. It's a different combination of private debt, public debt, lack of competitiveness, banking crisis, but it's not a crisis that is caused by the common currency. So then still the question is this crisis over? And the answer is yes, on one side it's over, and on the other side, no, of course it's not over. It is over in the sense that the probability for catastrophic events, or to be more specific, for the breaking up of the euro area, this probability has tremendously decreased due to a number of action taken by member states at the European level or by the ECB. This was not easy. I have a lot of respect, for example, what happened in Greece. Do they need to do more? Yes, of course. But the result is there is no longer an existential crisis for the euro area. But in another sense, the crisis is not over, because we still face very high levels of debt, public debt. This was shown by the governor's presentation at the beginning, but much less known and much less debated by private debt. And these two debt levels, in some countries you have more private debt, in others more public debt, you have some countries where you have both problems. This limits the availability of policy instruments or the effectiveness of policy instruments. But it appears that given this situation, the deleveraging process in the number of euro area countries, in the private as well as in the public sector, will continue for years to come and to have very likely a negative drag on growth. The second indicator why this crisis is not over is the high level of unemployment in the euro area, and especially for young people. One out of four young people in the euro area is out of the job. And we have a wide range of youth unemployment data in the euro area. On one side, you have Austria, the Netherlands, and Germany with the three lowest figures. But on the other hand, you have Greece, Spain, Italy, which have very high numbers, sometimes above 50%. They already have been high in most of these countries before the crisis. This is a signal that the labor market was not functioning even before the crisis started. But the situation has been aggravated during the crisis. And we have a risk that we overburden the young generation by these two features of the crisis, that they have no job and they have to repay the debt of their parents. So this, in my sense, is very clear. The crisis only will be over if we have more sustainable debt levels and have jobs that last. And this is then exactly the second question. Where do we need to go? Everybody would agree that is easy. We need sustainable growth, not boosted by credit expansion, either public or private, that boosts growth maybe in two or three quarters. We need to boost potential growth in the euro area, and by this create good jobs for the people. And it's not so easy to answer the third question: how do we get there? And in my view, and there is, I think, an emerging consensus what needs to be done, you need to have a policy mix out of, let's say, at least four pillars, because no economic policy area on its own can resolve the situation in which we are in. Yeah, it was alluded a number of times this morning that one should not overburden monetary policy. Monetary policy is not an all-purpose weapon to any kind of economic problem. Yes, you need, first pillar, a monetary policy that is geared towards price stability in the euro area as a whole. And on this, Benoit and Jens are much more suited to speak than I am. Second, you need a fiscal policy that is geared towards sound fiscal policies, because if you don't have this, you may reach a situation where your policy options are even more limited. We have seen this in a number of countries in the past. And yes, there's a broad debate what can be done in the current situation. Some countries might have fiscal space, others surely do not have fiscal space. And what is key to send a confidence signal is to stick to agreed European rules. If we give the impression that we do not respect and do not implement this kind of rules, this is negative for all of us. Third point that was mostly alluded to by nearly all speakers is the importance of structural reforms to boost productivity. And this applies to all euro area member countries, not just to program countries or former program countries. This is an ongoing task we all have to deal with. And the fourth pillar that is key is how do we institutionally evolve, especially the euro area? How do we integrate more? And this boils down to the critical questions after the banking union, what's next? You know all the headlines, fiscal union, political union, that has to go one hand in hand, because if you shift the power on taxes and revenues, the old principle applies, no taxation without representation, then you also have step by step in the same level to shift the democratic control and accountability in these questions. So this could very easily led, and here I will conclude, to a number of questions that has to be answered. Probably a new commission, this will take over the job in Brussels soon, can deal with, let's say, at least five questions that needs to be answered in order to make progress. First, we need to define what is the relationship between the EU and the euro area, because this question will be with us for quite some time. And this can be focused on what is the relationship between the banking union, which is an euro area task mainly, and the common market for financial services. Second, one needs to answer the question, how do we consolidate the rules of the euro area, which are currently laid down in a number of compacts, treaties, annexes to the treaties, intergovernmental treaties, into a single framework and integrate this further. For me, the core of the integration is the euro area, and this is not a closed shop. It's an open club, and Latvia is the best example. If you are willing and able, it's both, willing and able to join, you are more than welcome to join, and this is beneficial for the euro area. Third set of questions that one needs to answer is, what can we learn from Ukraine? That might sound strange to you, but this concentrates on areas like a common market for energy, which we currently don't have. Fourth question that has to be answered in the future, how do we deal with our neighbors? And this mainly relates for us in Europe to the east. How do we deal with countries like Ukraine, Georgia, Moldova in the foreseeable future? But it also very much focuses on the south, to our neighboring continent, Africa. It's probably not enough to send the boats in the Mediterranean Sea back to Africa. And the fifth and final question that one has to answer for us in Europe is very simply, how do we grow? And this is not so easy and obvious in a rapidly aging society. So here, investment is a key topic. I will not elaborate on this, many people have done this. The internal market, especially in services, is a key topic where we still have plenty of things to do. And governments deliberately did not do enough here in the past. But also, Jens Weidmann mentioned that briefly, trade agreements. Yeah, TTIP here is key. It's beneficial with all the critics that arise. Yeah, TTIP is not a way and should not be a way to lower environmental and social standards. But to have a market across the Atlantic where you have 800 million consumers altogether, already today, every single day, 2 billion of goods and services cross the Atlantic every single day. This is a huge chance for us to improve our growth potential. I look at the watch and here I stop. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this introductory remarks. I have one inevitable follow-up question. So you gave a very broad analysis with some detail, but I have one question about your area, present area of competence. This proposal recently voiced by Bruegel that a Europe-wide unemployment insurance could actually be considered as one of those next steps of closer integration in the Eurozone. So what's your response to this proposal?
Not now.
I mean, there are a number of proposals out under the heading of European unemployment insurance. They differ quite a lot. Some deal with cyclical unemployment, others with structural unemployment. Some are constructed in a way that you create a kind of shock absorber against asymmetric shocks to the euro area. Others are constructed in a way simply to organize permanent transfers inside the euro area. So the headline is always the same, but the content can be very, very different. I mean, if one has the aim only to shift transfers inside the euro area, one could have this goal. Then, in my view, there are easier instruments to do this than a complicated scheme where you compute output gaps and on this build transfers, then simply use EU structural funds. Yeah, go to the budget, you have parliamentary control and use this instrument. This is easy. If you have other ideas that you said we need a kind of cyclical stabilization, there's all the debate, the US budget is 20% of GDP, the EU budget is only 1%. I'm not sure if it's good to compare the EU budget because this belongs to the 28. We are talking more about the euro area where we have currently no fiscal capacity at all. This, in my view, could change and should change. If you have an unemployment insurance in a narrow sense, I have many questions because one has to tackle the fact that currently unemployment benefit schemes differ wildly within the EU. The replacement rate is very different. The interconnection between active and passive labor market policy has to be clarified, and this varies quite a lot within the EU. So currently, I would say the preconditions for a European-wide unemployment insurance are not met.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So I will now give floor to Professor de Boissieu for his introductory remarks.
Monsieur le Gouverneur, Mr. Gouverneur, thank you so much. I'm very glad to come back to Riga. I was there 2 years ago. And 2 years ago, I gave a lecture about the topicality of Schumpeter. You know, and in fact, I could do the same today, because I think that Schumpeter perhaps is still more topical now than it was 2 years ago. All the debate about supply side policies, how to boost potential growth, has something to do with Schumpeter, that is innovation, R&D, etc. And may I say that in order to repeat what was said, you know, at the end of the morning, early afternoon, it is more and more difficult, but nevertheless, may I say that I fully agree, Jörg, with what you said. You know, the Franco-German couple is working, you know, many times, by the way. And when you said our main issue in Europe or in some EU and Eurozone countries has to do with global and youth unemployment. If I had to take today the best indicator to assess the degree of social and political fragility in a country like France, I would take the ratio of youth unemployment, which is 25, that is average Europe. And I think that this could create, I'm not hoping, I make a distinction between normative versus positive statement, but you know, I think that we could be confronted in many European countries to, in a kind of, I would say, social or political discontinuity. I am not saying that we are on the eve of a new May 68. What I'm saying is that we must not underestimate the impact of this, combined with the fact that you were saying for the young people, they are facing two problems, unemployment and the debt problem. And in a situation where inflation is close to zero, and I guess this is my bet, it is going to stay very low in the next 3-4 years, beyond, I don't know. But in the next 3-4 years in the Eurozone, inflation will stay low. That means that we cannot count on inflation to alleviate either private or public debt. And therefore, we have to take other avenues in order, you know, to make private and public debt to be sustainable in the long term. Last introductory remark. I agree with you when you say the Eurozone crisis is not fully over yet, even if for me it has been well managed. In the debate, I think it is important to make a distinction between the fact that we have been through a big Eurozone crisis without a Euro crisis as such. The credibility of a single currency until now, and I hope it will continue, until now has not been diminished, has not decreased. And I take two indicators to illustrate what I mean. First, the exchange rate of the euro. Okay, it went down since June, but this is good for our competitiveness, but it is not bad for the image of the euro if we stay in those kind of values. And second, if you look at the market shares of the euro at the international level, I used to look at the IMF data, which are monthly data, which compute the currency composition of central banks all over the world. You know, the market share of the euro was 26 before the outburst of the Eurozone crisis. Today it is 27. The Chinese have not sold out euros. The Gulf countries have not sold out their euros, etc. And it is sure that we cannot, you know, sustain those kind of crises in the future, because at some point in the future, this gap that I am talking about, the fact that we had a Eurozone crisis without a Euro crisis, this gap will not continue in the future if we are exposed to, I would say, recurrent crisis in the Eurozone. That is, we have, as you said this morning, we have to better fix the system. Now, few remarks on three topics. Because, you know, we were asked to draw some lessons of what we have been through over the past years and to think for the future. remarks about monetary policy, about fiscal policies, and about France. This is the menu that I have to deal with shortly and quickly. About monetary policy, may I take the opportunity of having in front of me three eminent, at least perhaps more, I don't know, but I recognize at least three eminent central bankers of the Eurozone system, to say many thanks and congratulations to what you did. This, you know, in France we have a debate about the ECB. I do not participate to this debate, despite the fact that I am French. You know, I think that the ECB has been very pragmatic, much more than globally many people were expecting. And we must acknowledge this. And pragmatic and activist. And you know, I'm struck by the fact that in the debate, in the economic debate, some people are asking the question, must the ECB implement a kind of quantitative easing? And my answer is to say the ECB has already started to implement something which is close to the quantitative easing, even it is not exactly the same kind of QE as was implemented by the US Fed. Now, having said this, am I allowed to raise a few issues which have nothing to do with the way ECB has implemented its monetary policy, but which have to do with the effectiveness of ECB monetary policy, and the kind of problem that I am going to raise could be raised for the US, for any zone. They are not idiosyncratic specific to the Eurozone. First remark, the debate about inflation. Inflation is too low, okay, compared to the ECB target. Samuelson was saying, we have two eyes. If we have two eyes, it is to look at two indicators. He was talking of demand and supply, but here I am talking of two concepts of inflation. That is, I think that we are living in a world, and this is also true in the Eurozone, in the US, in Japan, everywhere, also in emerging countries, we are living in a world where we have to think with two concepts of inflation. CPI, inflation, on which the central bank is fixing its target, and asset price inflation, asset inflation, that is bubbles. For me, what we call bubble is the new name of inflation under the current circumstances. And if you look back for over the past 20 years at the world level, we pass from one bubble to the other. And we will continue in the future. This is my prediction. We will continue to pass from one bubble to the other. Sir Dennis Robertson, the quote-unquote enemy of Keynes at Cambridge University, was saying, the money which is nowhere must be somewhere. The money which is nowhere must be somewhere, that is in a situation where at the world level, also perhaps in Europe, in our countries, you have a situation of, I would say, excess liquidity. The money, you know, which is not given to the real economy is somewhere, and it is partially invested on, you know, asset markets, real estate, gold, commodities. You have a whole list of classes of assets. This is a first remark, and it is not a critique of the ECB policy of the Fed. It is the world in which we are living. A second remark has to do with the transmission mechanisms of monetary policy. 2 minutes, I have to accelerate. You know, we have to accelerate structural reforms, and I have to accelerate too. You know, therefore, about transmission mechanism, I say nothing, but it is a very important topic. About monetary policy, last remark, I think that we could have a problem of articulation between what I call the monetary leg and what I call the regulatory leg. I am a regulator in my country. I am a financial market regulator. But before, I was a banking regulator. For me, Basel III is good, globally speaking. in its principle. The problem is that I think that we have a debate about the calibration of Basel III, especially of the liquidity ratios. Some improvement has been made, but my bet is that one implication of Basel III in many European countries will be to perhaps to cut some bank financing for SMEs. And in many European countries, SMEs are crucial in order to boost economic activity and jobs. And for me, this is a problem. We are going to enter a new phase of disintermediation in many European countries, and we have to be ready for this. Small remarks about the second point, fiscal, the lesson concerning fiscal policies in Europe. We have improved our concept, and now with a reform, after the reform of the Stability Pact, we are looking at structural deficits. Okay, structural balances. But I have two problems. First, given what has occurred in Ireland and Spain, we know now that it is quite artificial when we talk about debt to look only at public debt. We have to look at overall debt, private plus public. And I think that when we are out of this crisis, that is perhaps in 3-4 years from now, we will have to change the treaties and the Stability Pact to say what is important when we talk about sustainability is not the public or the private, it is both. Because if you look at Ireland and Spain, there was a spillover effect from the private debt to the public debt. Second remark or proposal, in the Eurozone, I think that we have still a system of sanction which is not credible, which is not credible. We have improved the Stability Pact, but you know, we continue to live with this system where whenever a country is not complying with the rules of the game, this country will have to make a deposit with the ECB. This is only a pecuniary sanction. Mrs. Merkel, 3-4 years ago, proposed, I think, a very interesting proposal, which was refused by France at the time and some other countries, to say, could we think about more effective sanction whenever a country is not playing the game? And she was talking about political sanction, that is the fact that a country could be deprived of its voting right from some European institution, or she was talking about the fact that a country which is not playing the game could be deprived of the access to some structural funds. I think that we have to think about this. I'm not talking of France in particular, I'm talking in general. I think that our sanction system is not credible. I finish with two sentences about France. By the way, just one sentence about, before going to France, when I look today at Mr. Juncker's program, 300 billion euros in order to boost growth in Europe, I have a problem with this program. Because for me, this program is not credible because it is not financed. It is not credible as long as it is not financed. And when we say to turn to the EIB, for me, is a very good idea, European Investment Bank. But to turn to the European Stability Mechanism is not a good idea. We cannot mix. Minus three, just to finish about France. But France is not minus. But it is my time, which is minus. You know, as you know, we are facing a rather difficult situation today, but may I say that we are now really starting, perhaps some of you will say it is too late. I think it is never too late. We are starting serious structural reforms in order to reduce the cost of labor in France without in an internal devaluation, as opposed to Greece or Spain. We are introducing structural reforms concerning the labor market and the goods market. We are complying with the OECD and what Benoît Curé was saying about the sequencing of structural reforms. And we are in a kind of, not a game, because it is not a game, but a situation where, we are going, I guess, this is my bet, to get some delay concerning fiscal adjustment, fiscal consolidation, but provided that we give, concrete commitment to accelerate structural reforms. And concerning fiscal consolidation, I think that now Mr. Hollande at the start started by raising taxes. Now we have to cut expenditure. It is going to be difficult from the social and political point of view, but I think that there is no alternative for us today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So since there is -4 minutes now, I will skip my question and I will immediately give the floor to Professor Balcerovic, please.
Thank you very much. To be very diplomatic is a waste of time. So I am not going to waste your time. Let me start with, there's a lot of confusion in the debate about Eurozone and this continues. First, there's a lot of emotional words. Part of them are hate speech, like austerity. This is a hate speech. It used to be called fiscal consolidation, German approach. It's a hate speech. It does not mean a Second World War, but fiscal discipline. There's also manipulation of some previously well-defined expression, lender of last resort. It's completely different now than it was before. Nobody dreamt before 2007 or 2008 that any central bank would create lots of money to bail out governments. But some bankers pretend this is normal. Nothing has changed, a lot of change. This is a part of manipulation. Finally, and I think the top leadership of IMF has played a very negative role in pushing this new normal. I remember that they pushed Zapatero in Spain for fiscal stimulus, and he did it. And this has contributed to the problem of Spain. And they are still pushing, to some extent, to use the fiscal space which does not exist. Even in Germany, there's no fiscal space. If you look to a bit longer future. So it's a big negative service to the countries which have problems. Now, there are also excessive generalization. To speak about Eurozone problems is masking huge differences. By the way, what I'm saying is based on a recent article of mine which is published in Cato Journal, and there are some data. But just differentiation in the Eurozone between 2008-2013. Slovakia +0.2, Greece -23. Differentiation outside Eurozone in the European Union, Poland +12.5, Britain -4.5. Britain, by the way, in cumulative terms, is lagging behind France because they're only picking up now. There's a very interesting differences if you look at the top countries in terms of cumulated growth. From the top, you have Poland, Slovakia, Lithuania, Bulgaria, Sweden, Germany, Malta, Estonia, Latvia. These countries have been growing faster than the United States. Why? Well, some of them have avoided the boom. No boom, no bust. So this goes for Germany, I think, for Poland, for Sweden, for Switzerland. Some other top countries have suffered terrible boom and then the bust, but they did not hesitate in launching reforms. This is not only Latvia, which is the most spectacular case. There's a whole group of countries which I call Bell. These are Lithuania, Estonia, and Bulgaria. And they had a foul-shaped recovery. From the bottom, you've got Greece, Cyprus, Slovenia, Italy, etc. But there are also laggards among outside Eurozone countries with this time, like I said, Britain and Hungary. So huge variation. Now, looking at the Eurozone, what were the problem countries? Some of them were then subject to special treatment, Troika. Well, the problem countries first were those who suffered boom and then bust. And there are two kinds, I think, which are useful to distinguish. First, I called fiscal, which spills over to financial. This is Greece. The second one starts with financial housing boom and then spills over to fiscal, and there are very long mechanisms. And then you have laggards in accumulating distortions, postponing reforms. Like I would say, Italy and Greece and France. Behind these policies are, first of all, bad national policies. But is there something which can be linked to some specificities of the Eurozone or ECB? Well, in the literature, I haven't found one. In the Eurozone, there was an extreme suppression of the credit spreads. So until recently, Greece paid a little more than Germany. This was not typical for other hard currency groups. This is specific to the Eurozone. The spreads were much larger in the gold standard. The spreads, and this is surprising, used to be larger between the states of the United States than between countries of the Eurozone. Of course, it is very easy to blame that on the stupidity on the markets. That's market failure. You invent every day new market failures. But if you look at the literature, some people like the first one was Buiter, 2005, and then there some other countries have pointed out the potential reason, the treatment by the ECB of in the collateral policy of various countries, which according to these authors have sent a wrong signal to the markets. If this is the case, I don't know, but if this is the case, it would be interesting to know, has this policy been stopped or not? Now, so these are the problem countries between the Eurozone, and to some extent, these problems, either in the form of boom and bust or in the form of delaying reform, accumulating distortion, can be linked to excessively cheap and abundant credit. And by the way, this is nothing unusual. Countries which discover oil and gas have a lot of cheap money, and they tend to suffer similar phenomena. One of the expectations before creating the Eurozone was that since countries cannot devalue, they will be forced to take the productive and hard way reforms. But this expectation has not been fulfilled because there was one easy way, cheap credit, which delays reforms, allows credit booms. And when you look at the literature and the discussion before the creation of the Eurozone, there was one dominating worry, the lack of fiscal discipline as a danger. And this is why we had the Stability and Growth Pact, which, as we know, was violated. By the way, making something flexible means there are no rules. This is a new speak. No rules whatsoever. Pragmatic, no rules. Okay. But what is shocking, or what is very interesting, is that something which turned out to be even a bigger worry, to my knowledge, was not foreseen. Credit booms, finance, but excessively cheap credit. I may be wrong, but I haven't found. And this problem, I don't think it has been solved, which brings me to the policies pursued by since 2008. Now, as we know, there are two levels of these policies in the Eurozone or European Union, the European level and the national level. And two kinds of policies at each level, what is called crisis management. This is the name. Some policies may contribute to the crisis. Do not confuse names with the effects. And reforms. meaning fiscal and structural reforms. Now, what is striking is two things. There's a lot of rhetoric about European solutions. Whatever it's a problem, it should be European solution. But is there any European solution for the French problems? Would Germany finance rewards for the French politicians to be more disciplined? Or something of the sort? No, there are no European solutions for the French problems. There are no European solutions for the Italian problems. But there are French solutions for the French problems, and there are Italian solutions for the Italian problems, but the European level, which is mostly ECB, should not weaken incentives for the French politicians to do reforms and for the Italian politicians to do reforms. This is the math. At the European level, most of these policies were bailouts. There was a lot of discussion about European monetary stabilization mechanism, which is nothing else as European International Monetary Fund, and there has been a lot of discussions what is the net contribution of the IMF. As far as the behavior of the countries concerned is concerned, I think this debate is not yet settled. But I think the most important problem was the ECB policies, which is okay. Now, I don't think one can say that ECB policy cannot substitute for structural reform. That's true, but it's understatement. I think the continued unconventional monetary policy does not buy time, destroys time. By weakening incentive, not only for fiscal, for structural too. And of course, this is more general because it also true of Fed. Not only, they are more generalized. But in the case of European Union, you have OECD, there are some special problems. When Fed engages in buying federal government bonds, Fed is not engaging in regional policies. But when ECB does it, for Italian bonds, or say Portuguese bonds, this is de facto regional policy. Of course, every clever economist can justify in terms of monetary policy. Transmission mechanisms are not working, or we have care too about inflation, but it's not convincing. It's very clever, but it's not convincing. Now, there are two channels through which a continued unconventional monetary policy weakens growth, weakens. First, political channel. Second, there's slowing down restructuring in the banks and enterprises. By the way, there's quite a lot of research regarding Japan. The lessons of Japan has been hugely disregarded or misread, including public investment. In Japan, there was quite a lot of public investment, building bridges to nowhere, et cetera, et cetera. This has not helped. This has only contributed to a huge Japanese debt. Summing up, 2 minutes? Okay, if I can say, summing up. I think there are certain pseudo-solutions, or worse than pseudo-solutions. I put it quite bluntly. First, I think to propose something which sounds very nicely, European Fiscal Union. Of political union. It's not a solution. And I agree, Weidemann. Because either fiscal union means a German utopia, a perfect center who would watch that the regions are disciplined, but utopias are utopias, and you may have a very bad federal government, like in Argentina. So centralization is not necessarily a solution. Or call it French utopia, a larger transfer union, which of course would contribute to the disillusion of the European Union because we are not ready. So this is not, I agree that since these solutions are not solutions, then by elimination, one would have to try to go to the subsidiarity principle, which is nothing exotic. This is one of the basic fundamentals of European Union. And subsidiarity principles, as you know, includes responsibility for one's own actions, including the debt. It is instructing that in the European Union, There is no bailout clause on paper, which has been violated. In the United States, in Switzerland, you have de facto non-bailout clause. So I don't think other solution than try to go back. I understand that this is difficult, but this involves reduction in the unconventional policy by ECB. Otherwise, you can't. Now, if you look from with a bird's eye at the Eurozone countries after 2008, you can distinguish two groups. First, the group of countries which have been under special supervision. Greece, Portugal, Spain, Italy not. Well, and these countries have made a tremendous adjustment in terms of current account and competitiveness, price competitiveness, but except for Ireland, at much higher cost than the Baltics or Bell countries. And this, I think it can be shown that this is due to the fact that the Baltics needed less structural reforms or did more structural reforms and did not delay fiscal consolidation. Greece was already discussed. I can only say, based on what my very good student has written, there was a very bad composition of Greece adjustment, not due to Troika, but some other reasons. There were steps which meant rising taxes first, reducing spending much later, and structural reforms even later. You cannot expect other results than the cumulative GDP decline. This is the composition. And all the time we've heard that Greece was a victim of austerity. You know this propaganda? It was a victim of bad composition of adjustment. Now the second, and this is my last statement, the second group of those problem countries which are not yet subject to special treatment, which is Italy and France. Perhaps they are too big. And here we have a game of chicken between ECB and these countries so far. So these countries delay reforms, fiscal and structural, and the result, growth suffers. Then they are pressing the ECB to do something. They are not alone, financial markets are pressing too. ECB is saying, no, our monetary policy cannot substitute for structural reforms, and then gives in. And then we have a second round. So imagine in terms of game theory how this would end. Thank you very much.
So with that, I will actually quickly ask now, gentlemen, is there anything you would like to reflect on each other's thoughts now that all of you have spoken? If not, then we do as follows. We open now the floor for questions, but there is one technicality, since we don't want Professor de Boissieu to miss his plane. So please, if there are now questions to Christian de Boissieu, please ask them first. So I will ask those people who have questions to raise their hands. You will get a microphone then.
We are competing with a lunch. This is the problem.
I know, but still. So the inevitable question, of course, is should France be allowed to continue exceeding the 3% threshold?
You know, as I said, there is kind of implicit or explicit deal. That is, we cannot go to 3% next year, which was, we already got a delay by 2 years. From 2013 up to 2015. But I think that we have not used this time, I'm not a politician, I try to understand what has occurred. We have spoiled this delay, and therefore we are asking for a new delay, additional delay of 2 years. If you look at the figures, this year, the public sector deficit in France, according to the Maastricht definition, will be 4.4%, with a rate of growth, GDP growth, only of 0.4%. For next year, 2015, French government is forecasting a rate of growth which is 1%, about the same as the international organization. If you look at the IMF, not far from this, let us say 1% at most for me. Perhaps it will be less. And therefore, you know, we cannot increase taxes. I was in favor myself. I'm not, you know, I'm no more an official at all. I'm totally free to do what I want. I am again a fully irresponsible academic, okay? And therefore, I could say that as a fully responsible academic, given the fact that inflation is very low, I think that it could have been the moment to raise VAT. Because if inflation is low, we are around 0.3, 0.4 in France, that is Eurozone average. The impact on prices, by definition, would be low. And one point of increase in value added tax in a country like France for the normal rate brings you between $5-6 billion. It would have helped to adjust, but given the fact that Mr. Hollande and Mr. Hérault government before Mr. Valls did perhaps too many things to increase taxes, I think that the degree of sensitivity of French vis-à-vis any further increase in taxes, this degree now is zero, or it is very negative. And therefore, they don't want to increase the value added tax, and therefore, we have to cut expenditure at the three levels, state, municipal, local authorities, and social security. And I guess that the Commission, in a few days, will say to the French government, you have to do more for next year, because otherwise, the forecast for next year for the public sector deficit is about the same as the actual figure for this year. We will be at 4.3% next year. That is very far from the 3% limit. We could do more, but we will not be at 3% next year, in any case, except if we cheat. But I would not advise any kind of cheating, you know. You remember the debate before we launched the euro. Some countries, we are not number one, but some countries were cheating in order to be accepted. No cheating, we have to be transparent, and therefore, we have to negotiate. I think that the current government has to negotiate a further delay, which is bad for our credibility. But as I said, the price for France, the price to pay for this new delay, which must be the last, we must adjust, as you said, is, you know, serious commitment to make concretely structural reforms. And this is the debate, because if you look at our case, there was during a too long period of time, there was a gap between the wording, the words, and the facts. And it is here that we have to show to our German friends, to our partners in the Eurozone, I would say to the world, that we are able to be concrete and to make a concrete structural reforms.
Thank you.
This is my answer.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this. With that,
we let you go and catch.
I am allowed to go back after this answer.
Yes, but I have a question actually to Mr. Balcerovic. Professor Balcerovic actually did a lengthy interview with Riga's Laiks, so he's not only publishing with Cato. And one of the statements in that interview, which actually went into the title, was that there is unlimited political demand for economic miracles. And my question to you is, are the Eurozone institutions, it's clear about the national institutions, but are the Eurozone institutions and also the ECB in particular, also a victim maybe of that unlimited political demand for economic miracles?
Well, politicians differ, but you know, in every country there are some who would like to postpone adjustment for popularity reasons, and whenever they got easy finance, they tend to do that. This is elementary question of incentives. And if easy finance is provided by ECB, and this is the main source, called solidarity, etc., then we can, when facing such politicians, which is a fact of life, as a result, you have delays. The main point is you cannot avoid harsh choices. Just, there are certain realities where choices are harsh. And it is an illusion then to have an easier choice. It is worse than postponing. It is worsening because you may have a higher debt or worse situation.
Thank you. So now, yeah, there is one hand up here. Martin Shkazaks.
Martin Shkazaks, Swedbank. Thank you very much for fantastic, I would say also kind of very clear and entertaining panel. I thought that the longest words are in German, but now I know that the longest sentences are in French. But I have two very kind of brief questions. One is Europe the new Japan, okay, in terms of 1990s? So what do we expect about the long-term growth and things like that? And the second issue, the euro and Poland, what needs to happen? And when would it happen that Poland considers so joining the euro area? Thank you.
I can just speak for Japan and for Poland.
Maybe you start
Let
with Poland.
Let me start with Poland. You know, you can imagine that the idea of joining euro now, it's not very popular in Poland. To some extent, we are victims of our own success. Polish zloty is quite stable and fully convertible. And so you cannot easily convince people to support this idea. Secondly, we would need to change the constitution, which requires two-thirds majority, and you don't have this two-thirds majority in the foreseeable future. But having said that, I don't think this is the tragedy. Because if you look at the Eurozone, you have some problem countries and countries which not yet have problems within the Eurozone, which suggests that even in the Eurozone or outside the Eurozone, it is the national policies which count. We have to focus in Poland on what we need to do. And we need some extra reforms. First, we are facing aging. And we have to raise employment ratios among young and older people. Second, our investment ratio is low. And I speak about private investment is some 15%. Public investment cannot substitute for private investment. And finally, the growth of total factor productivity, which has been quite fast, 4.5, it's slowing down recently, and we still don't know what to do, which are the reasons. We are some suspicious. So it's better to focus on what is necessary to avoid a permanent slowdown in Poland's economy. On Japan, I am not an expert, or everybody's an expert. But my impression from the literature is that there were lots, for me, false interpretation. There are people who are saying Japan has not stimulated enough because they interrupted fiscal stimulus prematurely, they say. This is not very convincing, first. So. Second, they delayed changes in the banking. And this slowdown restructuring of the banks and of enterprises, which contributed to the selection bias. And finally, in Japan, there would be a slowdown in any case. They could not have maintained such a rate of growth because the slowdown would have occurred in because of demography. But this explains, from what I know, only 50% of the slowdown. So the remaining is, I think, due to policies. Remember Mr. Abenomics? It was very popular. Where is the third arrow? The first arrow was shoot. The second arrow, inflation is a bit higher, but there's no third arrow because structural reforms have been delayed. And I think this is, to some extent, a lesson. If you supply more money, the third arrow would be delayed.
Mr. Asmussen, any reflections on Japan, if not on Poland?
Yeah, it's obvious who of us is more suited to speak about Poland, so I
No, I will praise Germany and you praise Poland.
Yeah, I can praise Poland for its economic achievement, this is true, but I mean, if you want to join the euro area that's totally up to your citizens to decide. I mean, in Japan, and the comparison that was at least questioned for the euro area, I mean, some conditions are the same, like a rapidly aging society. Others are very different. If you look at, for example, corporate balance sheets, they are always now, on average, very healthy in the euro area, while that was different at the starting point of the crisis in Japan. So some things are equal, others are very different. In my view, the policy response in the euro area was suited and is suited to avoid a kind of Japan scenario. Because I think we have the lessons learned there. For example, when it comes to cleaning up bank balance sheets, which took a very long time in Japan, we had a relatively slow start in this field in the euro area with two banking stress tests that did not create enough credibility, at least not seen by the markets. Now this is in better hands with the ECB. But the key point to avoid this scenario that you describe is for us to increase the growth potential. This is not the short-term cyclical question. It's the structural longer-term question. And here you have labor, capital, and productivity. I mean, on the labor front, we are rapidly aging. We need to do all instruments possible to at least stabilize our labor supply. This means more skilled migration, even if this is politically heavily disputed. It's more skilled migration, higher female labor force participation, higher participation rate of elderly people, integrate long-term unemployed into the labor market, and fifth, to integrate people with handicaps into the labor market. On the capital stock, that's the traditional investment question that was discussed a number of times today here. This is key, public and private investment. For the public sector, it is the key question is about the composition of our expenditure. And for the private sector, it's how you create the conditions that private investment is attractive in Europe. And the third point was very deeply discussed by Benoît Cœuré when he talked about structural reforms that now have the task less to deal with the internal devaluation, but to deal more with how you could raise productivity. And Jens Weidmann also focused on this when he explained and gave data about the potential benefits of, for example, a common market for digital services in Europe.
Oh, thank you. So I saw a gesture from my colleagues which went something like this. So with that, please join me in a round of applause for our excellent panel. And now the floor is somebody else showing
this, that's what, not me. So. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, there are a few inevitable things, you know, this, taxes, there's also lunch, but there's also a plane for some of us who are leaving this afternoon. So therefore, I really hate it to cut the discussion short, because it was totally unexpected that we will have such a lengthy, such a interesting discussions, and interesting that I have to come to conclusion that the title of the conference which we gave 6 months ago is the wrong one. So we thought the crisis has ended. So we have agreed today the crisis has not ended. So the conference name could be, have we learned something in the first 5 years of the crisis? That probably should be. So, but it is clear the crisis is not over, but as colleagues mentioned here, it was well managed. I believe, speaking about rules, yes, rules have to be obeyed, but I think 1% deficit cutting and 1% here, I think it will not change anything. I mean, we could not fool ourselves. And I think, as Benoît Cure said this morning, the gradual approach also is not really working very well. So I think we have to organize many, many conferences. We have to meet again and again, and we have to finally agree on something. Yeah, we have to really, really have extensive discussion. I think winter is a very good period when there's bad weather outside, cold, so we could discuss and discuss, because I think it's really, really important, because we're coming from different countries, we're coming from different schools, we're coming from different legislations, and it is very, very important to continue this. Because when I went to the school, I was taught that Federal Reserve is lending only 90 days. Now we're lending 4 years. Unbelievable. And what is even more striking is that when the president of European Central Bank is now talking about monetary policy, we're talking about fiscal things, we're talking about structural things. So it shows that these things are really, really important, and we have to really continue these discussions. So I invite you to continue these discussions and to convince each other, because democracy is about convincing each other, to convince each other at lunchtime. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for coming, and I'm looking forward to see you in future occasions. Bye-bye.